there's only one that could come and make it right. So ain't no need for stressing and crying, 'cause he gon' show up just like he did the last time. And the last time, and the last time. I know, I know, I know. Won't he do it?
Won't he do it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Say what?
Fight your battles for you. They gon' wonder how you sleep at night.
Won't he do it?
Oh, yes, he will.
Yes, he will.
Anybody tell you something different, you know that's a lie. You gon'
praise the Lord, everybody. Y'all ready?
Bless me, bless me, bless me, God in heaven. Death has been defeated, he is our victory. Bless me, God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can have everything they need. Let all these folks that's with me, God, have everything. Say, bless me.
Bless me, bless me, bless me, God in heaven. Death has been defeated, he is our victory. Bless me, God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can have everything they need. Let all these folks that's with me, God, have everything they need.
Favor,
favor, favor, let it follow me, till I'm the conversation of all my enemies. Favor, favor, God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can have everything they need. Let all these folks that's with me, God, have everything.
Say favor.
Favor, favor, let it follow me, till I'm the conversation of all my enemies. Favor, favor, God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can have everything.
Let all these folks,
let all these folks that's with me, God, have everything.
Bless me.
Bless me, bless me, bless me, God, in me. Death has been defeated, he is our victory. Bless me, God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can have everything.
Let all these folks,
let all these folks that's with me, God, have everything.
Let all these folks,
let all these folks that's with me, God, have everything.
Let all these folks,
let all these folks that's with me, God, have everything.
Hey, y'all know this song. Y'all can help us move forward. We got everything we need. Hallelujah.
Persecuted, not abandoned.
We got everything we need.
Criticized, never forsaken.
We got everything we need.
Because God's a promise keeper.
We got everything we need.
I've got victory because
I've got everything we need.
I shall live and not die.
We got everything we need.
Because Jehovah's by my side.
We got everything we need.
Did I tell you he's a friend of mine?
We got everything we need.
Lift it up, lift it up.
I got everything we need.
Take it up, take it.
We got everything we need.
We got everything.
We got everything we need.
Everything we need.
We got everything we need.
Oh, oh, oh.
I got everything we need.
And I shall never forget.
We got everything we need.
'Cause he has never found me.
We
yet.
Got everything we need.
And every trial, every test.
We got everything we need.
We're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed.
God indeed, death has been defeated, he is our victory.
bless me, God, not just for me, but so everyone around me can have everything.
Let all these folks
that's with me, God, have everything.
Let all these folks
that's with me, God, have everything they need.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's the word right there, isn't it? Welcome, welcome to Crossroad Christian Church, where the disciples of God are learning we have everything we need. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So let's go to our God in prayer, amen? Father, we thank you that you have gathered us together today. Spirit of the Lord, fall fresh and anew. Teach us in this realm and in this dimension how to move, how to seek your face, how to hear your word, and how to be a part of your story, because in that, oh God, is your glory. So we thank you for sending Pastors Anthony and Margot Wallace unto us here in Dover, Delaware, shepherds after your heart, to teach us the word, oh God. Romans 3:23 says that all have fallen short and coming unto the grace of God. Father, you teach us about redemption. You teach us about renewal. You teach us about refreshing. And that's why we're here today. So God, together with our brothers and sisters to the left and to the right, those that are on the screens and those that are waiting to enter the sanctuary of the Most High God, we give you the praise. It's the power of agreement, oh God, that you are sovereign. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you for coming into the house today with us. Whether you're streaming in or sliding in, we know that you are coming for your deliverance. You're coming for your development, and you're on your way to your destiny. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everyone. Come to lift our hands and give him glory. Yeah, we've come to lift our hands and give him praise. Everybody in the room say,
come to lift our hands and give him glory.
We've come
to lift our hands and give him praise.
How do you know it? We've come to lift our hands and give him glory. Yes, we've come to lift our hands and give him praise. Everybody in the room say,
we've come to lift our hands and give him glory.
We've come
to lift our hands.
Glory, give him glory.
Glory.
We come
to lift our hands and give him praise.
Give him glory.
Give him glory. Glory.
Say
we've come to lift our hands and give him praise.
We're excited. We're excited. Y'all already doing it already, so we're gonna listen. We've come to clap our hands and send up Judah. Yeah.
Come to clap our hands and send up Judah.
We've come. Jesus. We're going to lift the name and we're going to say hallelujah. Is that right? Come on, let's say it. Everybody, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come to give him the praise, amen?
Yeah.
Well, good morning, I'm Evans Armand Trading. I'm gonna be sharing with you concerning the giving. I know you guys were tempted to see if I would just get your emotions going and continue that direction, but you knew I wasn't gonna do that, right? So Pastor Margaret said, I'll just praise in my seat,
uh-huh,
amen.
Uh-huh. That's what amen.
I don't know if everybody understands how church works. So I'm gonna give you like an insight. What church is like preparation and education for execution in your life outside of church.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
That's good.
So it doesn't really matter like if you scream and holler for 20 minutes here. It matters what do you do on Tuesday. You know? They say that when we experience pressure in our life, we don't like do what we desire to do. We fall down to the systems that we already have pre-existing in our life. So this allows you to say, oh, this is kind of cool. I enjoy this. And this is a great way to serve God. So I can put this into a system that I'll use throughout the course of my week and the course of my life. So when pressure does hit, I'll default to giving him the praise. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And it looks different on everybody. Like, you're probably not going to see me dance across the altar because that doesn't look on me. You know what I mean? So anywho, we're here to talk about giving. Not at all. Not at all. And the beautiful thing is that you're created new, so you don't have to be conformed to any image except for what he's designed of you. So be liberated in that if you're one of those that maybe don't do the happy dance like I don't. So, you know, when we talk about giving, last week we came out of 2 Corinthians chapter 9. You know, Elder Bowie was giving bets over there to see if I would dance. You know, it's kind of interesting, but we're going to stay focused. You know, 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And we talked about who Paul was talking to last week, right? We talked about he was talking to people who already predetermined to give. You know, this wasn't a compunction or a motivation to get you giving. These are people who predetermined to give. They already had a history of giving in abundance. But he's coming to visit them, right? And he wanted the Macedonians to see and them to be prepared for this visit so their testimony would be continually great. So now we're at chapter 6. That's where we ended last week. And he says, but I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. He who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposed in his heart, not grudgingly of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And we finished up last week, but this wasn't like, oh, well, you have to give bountifully. These are like, if you chose to give sparingly, it'll be multiplied sparingly unto you. It's a good thing. Like, any form of giving is good. And then those who chose to give bountifully, it'd be given bountifully unto them. And so, he said, God is able to make grace abound towards you that you always, having all sufficiency in all things, may have abundance in every good work. And this is that first song that we sung today, that you have. He supplied all your need. He has all grace abound to you. Then he says in verse 9, he says, as is written, he has dispersed abroad and has given to the poor. No one here should self-identify with that. Right? You know what I mean? You just know that it is. The poor in America has cell phones and have bikes. You know, it's kind of weird. You got an iPhone and you're poor. But in most countries, this means that you're struggling to find out food, shelter, Maslow's basic level of needs, right? You know, so he says to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. So now, may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and multiply seed and have shown an increase of the fruits of righteousness, while you are enriched in everything with all liberality, which causes thanksgiving through us to God. So I'm just going to finish up here. I know I got like a minute left, but it's this idea of your giving helps you with your self-identity. So he's saying, hey, he's going to supply seed to the sower, right? So you have to figure out, who am I? You know, who are you in him? Well, I'm a sower. And because I'm a sower, I always have seed. I'm not one who's giving with the hope to get seed. I'm a sower, so I always have abundance. I'm an abundant giver, so I have abundance, and I give from that abundance. I'm not trying to give a lot to hope that that will produce abundance. And the image that we hold of ourselves helps us guide our life. So part of giving does, it allows you to identify with a giver. And initially, right now, you may be someone who says, I'm just going to give because, you know, they say you're supposed to give and Satan won't kill your stuff and all kinds of stuff. Well, just continue to give. And over time, you're going to have a track record that looks back and says, I've been giving for like 15 years, so I guess I am a giver. And you'll believe that you're a giver and you'll have much to give. You know, so we're always voting for that. So God's helping us engage into this identity of who Christians are. And one of the things we are, we're cheerful givers. Amen. So with that, and I know for some of you guys are like, man, that was deep stuff and whatever, but you'll get it as you continue to give. You'll go, I'm a giver, and that's why I give. Whatever you choose to give. But we know our giving begins with a tithe. So, Father, we just love you. We know that there's five areas to give. You'll see on the Jumbotron as I pray. We just love you. We thank you for the opportunity to give. We thank you that you said you supply seed to the sower and we predetermine in our heart that we are sowers. So you're going to give a seed. Many of us have chosen to be abundant givers, so we have abundance to give from. And we thank you that we're able to enjoy that, and you're able to continue to lend to the poor. Later on in the scripture, you say that this giving is what provides needs for the saints and continue to expand the gospel. And we thank you that people get to know who Jesus Christ is today because we, the believers, chose to give. In Hebrews, consistently, you teach us that it's a testimony that Jesus Christ is Lord. And so we testify, even with our giving, we have a reference point that you are our source and the money is just the resource. We glorify you, God, and we continue to magnify you as you continue to teach us who we are in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello, Crossroad family and friends. Welcome. Please see the following announcements. Crossroad fam, mark your calendars for July 31st. We have a dynamic husband and wife duo who will be gracing us with worship and word. Prophetic psalmist Harvey Randall and his wife, prophetess Sherry Randall, will be our honored guest that last Sunday of the month. Invite your family and friends. You and they don't want to miss out on a blessing. Crossroads, stay tuned. The annual Crossroad Cookout is coming soon. Fun times are ahead as we prepare for this year's cookout. More information to come very soon. Thank you. That is all for today.
Glory.
You turn shame into glory.
You're the only one who can.
season to highways. You're the only one who cares. You turn graves.
You turn graves into gardens.
You turn bones into armies.
You turn bones into armies.
You turn seas into highways.
Beloved, it's good for us to be here this morning. I hope you don't mind. You can never give God enough praise. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There's no one better than you. There's nothing better than you. And so we worship the God of our salvation. Greetings to all of you in the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you for coming out on these hot days, hot Sunday, but a blessed Sunday. It's a good Sunday. That we're breathing, and we have the activity of our limbs, we have the goodness of God in our hearts, and we're going somewhere. We're getting better with time. Amen. Come on, lift up your hands and give God praise. Thanks be to God. Before you have your seat, I'm going to go old school. Will you join me in the book of Mark this morning? The book of Mark, chapter 16. The book of Mark, chapter 16. I sense something in the atmosphere. You can't see it. You can't put a finger on it. But by the discernment of the Holy Spirit, we know, I know that this is a special day. It's a special day for you. Some of you, your eyes are going to come open today for the first time in a long time. Mm-hmm. Glory to God. COVID didn't kill you. The devil didn't destroy you. You still have options. You still have resources. You still have people that love you. You're always going to have people that hate you, but we don't concentrate on the haters, amen? We just appreciate life in God and the family of God and an opportunity to come and worship together. It's so valuable. We praise God for each of you that have come out today to be a part of this worship experience. And also, I want to give special greeting to those that always join us by way of the internet, not just here in our vicinity, the East Coast, Dover, but we have people that join us from around the country, different places. I know we have people in the South, South Carolina, this family up in Maine, extended family here. So I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, the Bible says that when we greet one another, let's greet one another with a holy kiss. Now, don't be alarmed. We're not going to go around attacking folks with our lips. Because we exchange pleasantries. But to you that are viewing by way of the internet, I blow you a holy kiss in the name of Jesus. And we say we love you just the same, even though miles can separate us. Praise the Lord. Now, before I read the scripture, I want to recognize the time in which we live. There are those of us that live, we live in perpetual victory because... and I'm thanking God for Elder Evans, man. What a powerful word, always, always, always. But he's made a choice to live in perpetual victory. And so it's hard to get a person down, keep a person down. But we recognize, as he said, an appreciation for the different personalities and the levels of adversity that you go through, both in your life and in the life that the toxicity of the world that you live in brings us. And so there are days when you can feel a little down, amen? It's okay to say that. I'm just saying, well, that's not a confession of faith. No, it is a confession of truth. David said, I cried all night long. My pillow was wet with tears, and I didn't even know if God was going to show up by morning. So it's okay. So all those testimonies, they're segments, they're chapters in which this chapter was a little more cumbersome than the last chapter, but in all of it, God is glorified. In all of it, the victory of Christ is assured. In all of it, we are loved by God and accepted by others. And so we have manifold reasons to rejoice. This is a good day. I want to help somebody know that you didn't know how you were going to make it to this day. And now you can forget about it because you made it. Amen. Glory to God. You can just give God praise. So I want to talk. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but I want to talk specifically to people that have been down. You've been a little bit discouraged. The multiplicity of things that you have to deal with in your life can seem to be overwhelming, but you're still here. Not only are you here, you're in the right place. You know, I'm reminded of Jesus healed that one man by the pool when there were literally hundreds, maybe thousands of people by the pool. He just heals one man. It makes Jesus seem unfair, and then he puts it in scripture for us to consider, and we'll consider that until he comes again. He tells the man, take up your bed and walk. You're relieved of your burden. You're relieved of your malady. You're relieved of an injury that you made an industry out of. You made an industry out of being sick. Are you hearing me? But I came to let you know, maybe that's why. He says, take up your bed and walk. Here's what religion does. Religion will not allow you to celebrate the victory of another. It's nothing but criticism. Oh, she should have been did that. What you doing carrying that bed? You know it's the Sabbath. 38 years he couldn't walk. He couldn't get up. So we can have the bad attitude in the right place. The next time Jesus sees him, he's in the synagogue, seated. That's the position of learning, education, information, and revelation. And he commends him with a warning. He says, look, you're doing so much better. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord. I'm paraphrasing. But also, don't go back to the old life. He says, don't go back to sin. He says, or else you run the risk, listen, of a worse thing coming upon you. I don't know who I'm talking to today. If it's just one person, I have my assignment. Don't go back to where you came from. Don't go back to the attitude that he delivered you from. Don't go back to all the things that kept you separated for so long. Embrace this new day. This is a new day. This is a new time. This is a day of refreshing for you. Amen. Am I talking to anybody in here? Do I have the right people this morning? Praise the Lord. Having said that, let's consider our scripture, Mark chapter 16. And we want to begin at verse 15. Some people call it Mark's version of the Great Commission. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, every person. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned, or we'll say doomed. And these signs shall follow them that believe. These signs shall follow them that believe. He says, in my name they shall cast out devils. You'll have authority over wicked spirits. They shall speak with new tongues, or in one translation, a whole new language, a kindred language, but a different language. And verse 18, they shall take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. So then, after the Lord spoke to them, he is received up into heaven. We get the feeling this is the last thing that he told them before he ascended. This is what's going to happen to those that believe. So today I want to talk about one of the things he said, given the controversy that's going on in the church and in the world. I want to talk about tongues. I want to talk about new tongues. I want to talk about a new language and the reality and the priority and the importance of receiving tongues from God. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that there's no way we could approach this subject matter in our own might or in our own strength. And so we prayed and meditated. We have lifted up our voice in our understanding and in our heavenly language that we'll learn about today. And we thank you that you confirm your word with signs following. What signs? Signs where people are born again. People come to you to be saved today. People that have lost their way or slipped away, Lord, they find their way back to you today. And that relationship is strengthened and tightened like never before. We praise you for what you're going to do. We praise you for what you're going to show. We praise you for what you're going to share. And we praise you in advance for those hearts that will be immutably changed by the power of your word and the Holy Spirit's influence on that word. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said amen and amen. You may have your seats in the presence of the Lord. Now, again, we probably won't get through this, and I'm going to revisit this on Wednesday night as we gather also, because there's much to cover in this topic. Two things led me to this. Number one is the ongoing controversy between a subset of subjects that just always seem to be so controversial. Just weeks ago, we heard a prominent minister in the body of Christ begin to say that he had been teaching the tithe incorrectly and we're no longer under the law, and so tithing is not in effect today, right? That's going to be very divisive. There are people that live by the principle of the tithe. I live by the tithe. My household's governed by the tithe. This house is governed by the tithe. Amen. But I'm going to let you know, I agree with the minister. We're not under the law. There is no statutory requirement in that sense for you to tithe. See, because what God made legal in the Old Testament, you do by revelation in the New Testament. Some people in the Old Testament never had a revelation of the tithe. Let's just talk about that. They never had a revelation, so they had a regulation. A regulation that says, this is honors me and this is good for you. It was a regulation, so I want everybody to do that. But now Jesus Christ has come and all those Mosaic, Levitical, all those 613 laws essentially are done away with. And so when Christians hear comments like that, you've been in a tithing church, you hear a prominent person say you don't have to do it, there are some Christians live with a readiness for what they can reduce. In other words, they want to hear with a readiness to what they can make an excuse for. Understand, no judgment. Everybody's at a different level. Everybody's at a different place. But if you hunger and thirst after righteousness, God has a promise that you and your vessel, your heart and your mind will be filled. And once you're convinced and convicted like that, no one can take you off of it. I don't care what their name is. I don't care what their degree is. I don't care what their specialty and their gift set is. This is the word of God, and it's alive, and it's producing what God said it would produce. Am I in the right place so far? So it's those types of things. So you have on the one hand that at ever frictional subject of the tithe, all right? I'm not dealing with the tithe. I've asked a minister to prepare himself to teach us on the tithe, all of us together, and I would encourage you to come for that, or if you can't come, obviously tune in. So the one is the tithe, and the other is the tongue. There are people that debate about the tongues. Tongues is for today. Tongues is not for today. Those of you that really want to know, you're going to go home and you're going to do like you do with everything. You're going to research everything on the internet, and you're going to find Dr. Pharaoh and Reverend so-and-so. They're going to tell you tongues is why we don't need it. No such thing as this and that and the other. I'm saying don't be moved. I have committed this time to the Holy Spirit to teach you. The Holy Spirit is a better teacher than any man on the earth. The Bible says he shall teach you all things, and he will bring back to your remembrance whatever things I have said unto you. So Jesus said you'll speak with new tongues, right? Who? Them that believe. I just want to, let's set the stage. Don't have to be an apostle. Don't have to be a big wig. Don't have to be some special person that's fasting and praying and calling on the Lord and you out in the wilderness like John the Baptist with a jar of honey and a mohair suit. No, he says these signs right here shall follow anyone that chooses to believe. So know this, you have the capacity and the potential as a believer to deal with devils. You can release your faith by saying amen. Amen says, so be it. See, you're trying to figure it out. God said, this is it. This is fact. And so a lot of people get in trouble because they're trying to be, and I believe it's a cerebral pastime. You have to use your mind to serve the Lord. But when God makes a statement, he says, I'm telling you as a disciple that you will have authority over demonic spirits. I'm already sensing, I'm sensing victory on the one hand, and there's Satan punching at the door to try to get you not to believe it. So you want to call somebody, and we do call and we join in prayer. But as a believer, born again this morning, yesterday, you have authority over demonic power because you are in the kingdom of light. If you believe it, just wave your hand. If you believe it, you believe it. So if you believe it, exercise that. You tell your kids, this is my house, and if you ain't right, I'll throw you out. Well, you need to say the same thing with the devil. You can't live here. You can't be here. You can't bring up, how about this house? We're going to get into a minute. This house comes with all kinds of grievance and grumps and grime and all kind of stuff, weights and things, all kinds of anger issues and this and that and the other. You can tell the devil, that ain't a landing zone here. I'm full of love, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. This is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Somebody say Holy Ghost. That's really who we're talking about today. He says, these signs shall follow. You're going to be able to deal with devils. And the next thing he says is that you'll be able to speak with new tongues, right? So we're going to talk about tongues today. Do you have that first clip for me? All right. So I decided to do this because we have people that are very, very, very academic. My dad was that way. Before he got filled with the Holy Spirit, he spent a lot of years trying to figure out how it works. Because my dad was analytical, he was a flight engineer, he was a master mechanic. He was very, very scientific and orderly in his thinking. So in that sense, he desired the Holy Spirit, but his mind was getting in the way of how to receive. And I remember the moment when he received. I just made a statement to him, I'm like, just understand, you will not be able to figure this out because it doesn't make sense. And some people say, if it doesn't make sense to me, then ain't no way that it can be. God says, who said what makes sense to you is important to me? I've already provided for your well-being as a child of the kingdom, all right? So now, again, I probably won't get very far down the road, but it's just as far as we go. But I am compelled, like I haven't been in recent times, about this message, because what I see is people, those of us, we get beat down, you're getting attacked, you on all kinds of social media, all kind of messaging, all kind of opinions, all kind of ideas, and God's voice gets softer and softer in the background of all that. So now God's going to speak to us today about how to get your groove back on that. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're mighty through God. They're not carnal. They may seem stupid, but God says they're powerful. And how about you? I want to flow in the power of God. Not so I can be somebody, I am somebody, and that's why I got the power of God to deal with issues, as the minister said, not in church. Get happy in church, scream and holler, and help. Hopefully that'll help you convince yourself that you got the power when you walk up out of here. That you, man, play the clip, give God praise, just pray that clip. Yeah, all right. Turn up the volume.
Thanks for watching our internet edition of Nightline. I'm Martin Bashir. Today, we examine the Christian practice of speaking in tongues. Those outside the church often say it's nothing more than gibberish, but some Christians claim that it's the purest form of prayer beyond the constraints of normal language. Nightline's Vicky Mabry reports on the science of speaking in tongues.
It is an ancient.
Okay, that's it. That was enough. It's only supposed to be 30 seconds because it's a lengthy video, and maybe on the chat or whatever, we can put that link so you can watch it, right? Because it's really important. So they're doing this, they're examining this on Nightline or whatever it is. Can you quickly bring up the other one? I was going to wait. Let me know. Give me a thumbs up if you can bring me up. I think it's 2 minutes and 19 seconds. All right, so ABC Nightline, they're examining this thing from a secular perspective and from a scientific perspective. Working on it?
Control over what comes out of their mouths, that they're swept up in a rush of ecstatic religious feeling.
and that the Holy Spirit is speaking through them.
Do you hear yourself?
Oh, yeah. Sometimes I think I sound like a total idiot.
See? It's almost all in yellows and red here.
At the University of Pennsylvania, Dr. Andrew Newberg is looking for an explanation for what most regard as unexplainable.
I mean, it's not language. It's not regular language, at least, that would normally activate the frontal lobe.
Newberg is exploring the relationship between faith and science, studying what happens in the brain during the deepest moments of faith.
If we're really going to look at this very, very powerful force in human history of religion and spirituality, I think we really have to take a look at how that affects our brain, what's changing or turning on or turning off in our brain.
They're going to go around very fast right now.
He's recently published a study of Americans speaking in tongues. Remarkably, he discovered that what's happening to them neurologically looks a lot like what they say is happening to them spiritually.
Make sure we got your whole head in there.
We asked Pastor Jerry Stoltzfus to come to the university to have his brain scanned while he speaks in tongues. This way, we could see the experiment in action.
I don't think faith is anything to be afraid of from science. Science validates faith, so bring it on. Whatever the facts are, bring it on.
Just go ahead and you can begin prayer. And
first, he's told to pray in English.
Father, I pray for each of the family members involved in this study. Grant them what they are looking for in their personal lives, for their vision and their potential.
Then he's told to speak in tongues.
This is the first scan when he was in prayer, speaking in English. This is the second scan when he is praying in tongues.
Pastor Stoltzfus's scan showed that his frontal lobe, the part of the brain that controls language, was active when he prayed in English. But for the most part, it fell quiet when he prayed in tongues.
When they're actually engaged in this whole very intense spiritual practice, religious practice for them, their frontal lobes tend to go down in activity, but I think it's very consistent with the kind of experience that they have, because they say that they're not in charge. It's the voice of God, it's the Spirit of God that's moving through them.
Dr. Newberg says the results were even more dramatic on subjects who were scanned without a Nightline crew in the room and who were not speaking in tongues on demand, as Jerry Stoltzfus had done. Study participants like Donna Morgan first listened to music, then went to where the Spirit took them.
Pause it, pause it. So, so pursuant to what we heard earlier, here's the pastor just laying down. And this lady, she's getting into, see, she probably went to a church like this a little bit. But I want you to know, I just want everybody to know, you don't have to work yourself up with that. That's just where she is. Praise God. Her life is a blessing. I appreciate that. So here's a place where we can judge each other really harshly on what we believe and the manifestation of that belief. I'm going to share with you one verse. If it's not today, I'll get to it Wednesday. But let me share. You can write it down now in case you know how it is with me. 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 40, which says, let everything be done decently and in order. Okay? That's significant. I don't know if I have a revelation about that, but there's a lot of complaints, not without reason and not without cause, as to why people in the 21st century doubt the veracity and the methodology of speaking in other tongues, particularly in a church setting, right? Prayer language, some of you know what I'm talking about, versus a message in tongues with interpretation, which equals prophecy. So we want to be clear on that so that you can have an unshakable attitude towards what God is doing in your life. And we don't have to violate scripture, because at the end of this, the last verse in chapter 14 is, whatever you do, let it be done decently and in order. The only thing I'm going to ask you to consider is, we are 2,000 years removed. We are 2,000 years removed from thereabouts, give or take, from what Paul is writing to this Corinthian church. Bear that in mind as we move forward. Okay, go ahead.
Hallelujah, Santa to Media, Satan to your Sato. Habababababo, Santa to Media, Santa to Media, Santa to Media, Satan to Media, Santa to.
When I heard about the study, I already knew within my spirit that it was going to be proven that there's a part of our brain that we have no control. That when the Holy Ghost is interceding for us, we're out of control.
Stop. So the language there can be misleading. We aren't in control. That's what she said, but that's not what is meant. You are in perfect control. She didn't go all over the room acting crazy. In fact, the brain scan that they did just proved that if you're speaking in your native tongue or a language known to you, that front part of your brain which controls that is highly active. However, when you go pray in tongues, whether it's this lady here or whether the pastor laying on the table, that language center is shut down even though you're speaking a language. I wanted to do this because I wanted to deal with the skeptics up front. I want to deal with you because it don't make sense to you, but we got a doctor that says this is actually what's happening in a clinical setting when you engage in this particular spiritual activity. So there has to be something to it. And the reason why I'm saying that is because I remember Bishop preached a message years ago, pray in tongues more. Pray in tongues more. And I dare say if I was to take a toll a lot of times or a poll, we pray in tongues less. I think for some people there's a direct correlation between what you know informationally and what you do spiritually. People that are intellectual, they hold that on high esteem. Remember, Paul says, I'm taking all my education, all my degrees, my law degree, and I'm casting it down at the foot of Jesus that I might know him in the power of his resurrection. I don't want to know about him. I want to know him. And since he saved me, he's the one that saved me. I need to know him. So when you come to church, when you engage in activity, when you read your Bible, it's all about knowing him. It's not about knowing church, because churches are, you know, you got church, every kind of church you can imagine. And I want to say to you how I view that is these are tributaries of the body of Christ. But because I'm not a part or I don't agree with a certain thing does not invalidate the validity of that church in the minds of Jesus Christ, who is the founder. Can I get one amen out of that? But I wanted to make you aware that what we believe spiritually is now being proven scientifically. I want to say it again. What we believe spiritually, what the Bible told us 2,000 years ago, when there were no brain scans, is proven today. That's why skeptics about prophecy or what the Word of God is advancing will say, that don't make any sense. No, you just haven't come into it on the continuum of time. It was this way from the beginning of the world. All this was planned. All this was set up. Are you hearing me? And so I feel faith arising for somebody that you hadn't spoken in tongues lately. You just need to start. You need to start. And if you haven't, you receive Jesus Christ, you need to embrace this gift. And I just want to be fair with you. The reason why is because of days ahead. The Bible says that perilous times will come. Men will wax worse and worse. Men love darkness rather than light. They've turned the lie into the truth and turned the truth into a lie. Anytime you get into a cultural conversation, you find out just how crazy we have become. You speak in tongues and they tell you you're crazy. Let's not talk about what's crazy. I'm saying unto you, beloved, you, me, and we need the power of the Holy Spirit working in our lives, and we need to engage in what Jesus said would happen and what Paul admonished us to be about in terms of praying in the Holy Ghost. Amen? Amen. Amen. I'm glad to see the enthusiasm. All right, let's finish.
In earlier studies, Dr. Newberg looked at what happens in the brains of Buddhist monks meditating and Franciscan nuns praying. And it was noticeably different from what happens to tongues.
Buddhist chant, all those people, what is happening with Christians is noticeably different from other people who are engaged in deep religious meditation, prayer, and activity. Ha, ha, ha. I wanted to get down there. This may be all we get tonight. I really want to prime your pump to see when you come back and hear the rest of the story, because I know you got places to be today. But I am convinced God is saying, turn up the heat, brother. God is saying, God is saying to some of you, it was your mouth that got you in trouble. It was you running your mouth with the wrong thing. He scolded me, Wallace, it's your own mouth that got you in some of the trouble that you're in. So I got to fix your mouth with your cooperation. God's not going to fix your mouth without you agreeing. The point is, right here, they say Buddhist monks and people that are chanting engaged in their form of prayer, but he just said it was different. Listen.
That's in fairly stark contrast to the people who are like the Buddhists and the Franciscan nuns who are in prayer, because they're very intensely focused. And in those individuals, the frontal lobes actually increased activity.
But Dr. Newberg isn't out to prove or disprove anything. He can tell you what happens in the brain, not why.
Were you skeptical going into the studies?
If by skeptical, the question is this a real phenomenon, meaning that this is truly the voice of God speaking through them? That's a much more problematic question, I think, and something that I'm not sure that we've specifically answered simply by doing our study.
But for those who believe, it doesn't matter if science can find the footprints of the Holy Spirit in their 21st century brain scans.
When you've experienced this, you don't really care what anybody else thinks. It's personal in the first place. It is something between you and God. So we don't really care if it's validated or not, but it's fascinating when it is, so that people that have thought we're crazy can have something to look at to say, maybe we're not, we're still crazy, we're just not as crazy as they thought.
Thank you so much.
This is Vicki Mabry for Night.
All right, good, thank you. Give Jesus praise. Did anybody find something useful just with that? Something useful, right? So we'll search everything else, but you can use the internet to search out the tenets of your own faith. And we're finding out that what God said is now being corroborated, right? It just takes time for people to catch up. I just wanted to note, before we move forward, that we had Buddhist monks and we had Franciscan nuns. Is that what it was? So we have Buddhists, right, who may be Jehovah deniers, engaged in their religious prayer activity. And it's just like they're speaking a language. Their language center is active, even more so than when we would speak in English, because it's intense. It's a focused prayer or language activity. What's really surprising is Franciscan nuns, because the Franciscans, although Catholic, you can divide the Catholics from the other Protestants, right? But the Catholics believe in Jesus. So you have people that believe in Jesus that still aren't operating in this. Follow me? I just want to point out that distinction moving forward. Now remember, this isn't for you to feel good about it if you pray in tongues all day long and half the night every day. That's not what this is about. In fact, let's do a little background. turn your Bible to 1 Corinthians. We'll do a little bit of work before we let you go today. Are you still with me? So here's one of the problematic scriptures when it comes to this speaking in tongues or praying in tongues. And I just want you to know, my personal preference is I use the term speak in tongues, but it's more correctly praying in tongues. It's praying in tongues. And Paul says that all throughout this instructional letter in 1 Corinthians. So when we say speak in tongues, it really should be praying in tongues in this instance that we're reading right now. So 1 Corinthians, it says, where are we at? Was it verse? Okay, right. So, verse 12, even so you, for as much as you are zealous of spiritual gifts, seek that you may excel to the edifying the church. So right there, he deals with motivation. So let me just say, the whole reason why this letter was written was to bring correction to this Corinthian church. Remember, we've talked about Corinth many times, how a carnal, it was a city steeped in philosophy and whatever's new. It was a very knowledgeable city, but it was a very carnal city, and it was a pagan city. They worshiped any number of gods, male and female deities all over. So listen, so you watch this now. You can receive Jesus Christ and still have remnants of the old life that affect you. It's like spiritual, physical, emotional, muscle memory that you bring across. Because as was said earlier, you have to grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You don't earn a PhD because you got graduated third grade. You got to put some work in, and there's going to be some sacrifice and tremendous cost in terms of money, time, effort, and so forth. And you'll probably run into times where you want to quit. You don't want to do it. But if you really, after the PhD or after that goal, you're going to put necessary effort. Amen? So what I'm asking you is, don't just hear me preach today. Go back and review this. Get your Bible out and begin to pray about, God, give me understanding beyond my normal level around what you're trying to say to me. Because this is as much about the future as it is about right now. I'll just say it this way. We don't really know how to pray. Most Christians, we pray out of bias. We pray out of selfishness. But the Bible says that we need to seek God by His Spirit, because He knows what is the mind of the Father concerning all the things that we're going to do. You, me, us, and then all these other things that He has us praying about in the Spirit that you could never pray about with your understanding because you don't have the information. But the Spirit has the information. Man, I feel something moving right here. I feel like it's dropping in on a couple hearts right now. So if you don't understand it, just embrace it. Just embrace it. If it doesn't fit, it doesn't work, throw it out with the evening trash. But I believe God has us in this place for a reason. He has you in the earth to make a difference. He has you in the earth to make a difference, not make a living. Right? And so I'm going to make a difference for whatever time I have left. Amen? So he wrote this letter to them, and he says, so this church was disordered in three areas. Three areas. You can write this down. This is good background information. So the church was disordered in these three C's. They were disordered in their conduct. I hope that's not us. They were disordered in their conduct, and he lifts this up in chapter 5, verse 1 by saying, hey, it's commonly reported that fornication is a thing with you. You guys just have an inadvertent sex, one with the other and so forth. And he says, and to make matters worse, if that's not bad enough, he says, you've taken it to a new level that I've never even heard the Gentiles take it to. What is that? That a man would have his father's wife. So God is going to get into your business. God is going to address some things behind the bedroom door, behind the locked vault of what you want to keep secret. And thank God he's not going to make it public. We never know the man's name. So God is protecting you while he's leading and guiding and directing you. So they were messed up in their conduct. You know well that they were messed up also, the second C, they were messed up in their communion. Remember, he scolds them in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 about, don't you guys have food? Why y'all coming to the party and acting the fool up in here? Because number one, they were immature. And number two, there were still holdovers from the pagan life. So I don't know why we expect everybody to walk like you with your perfect high-level Christianity self when they just got saved 5 years ago. You still working on things that you won't admit to me. I'm still working on things I would never want you to know. Because if you knew, you'd throw me up out of here. We always trying to drop the dime on somebody else. God says, listen, you was aware of a mirror before you was ever aware of a window. He says, take a look in the mirror. Michael Jackson said it best. I got to take a look at the man in the mirror because he's the problem. He's the guy that's got to make a change. You can't even see other people right until you see yourself right. That's why he says, when you love God with all your heart, then love your neighbor as yourself. You think your neighbor is next, but if you don't love yourself, then you can't love your neighbor, and you can't love yourself if you don't know yourself, and you can't know yourself unless you know the one that knows you better than you know you. Oh, I need somebody to give God a praise. I mean, can we be so bold as to exercise our faith? You don't have to stand up. I just want you to stand up and give God a praise for about 10 seconds real quick. Help this preacher come to a close. Hallelujah. 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 I receive it, Lord. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. You can sit down. Thank you. So they were messed up in their conduct. They were messed up in the communion, something that God showed them and told them how to do. Paul has to come through with correction. Watch this. It doesn't mean they're inferior Christians, just like it doesn't mean you're one. And yet we are inferior in some things as we're growing in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So the first was their conduct, crazy conduct in the church of the living God. Love God, but hate you. I like Elder so-and-so preaching, but I don't like yours. Pastor them got favors with people. Whatever the craziness is. And you live on that, and because you're insecure, you share that with other people to get them on your bandwagon so you can have validation in your insecurity. And God says, that's the reason why I want you to pray in tongues, so you can get rid of all that nonsense. You come into church, we're all one family, but now you think you're against him and he's against her and there's a clique over here and that over that. No, that ain't never been preached here. If you come up with that, you came up with it on your own. And like Paul, we got to correct that. Bad conduct. Bad communion. Leave your gift and go make it right. I don't want to do that. And I got to take communion so I can look right because I'm an elder. I'm a this. I'm a prophet. I'm a this and that. You'd be surprised what people think they are that they never told you. You put enough pressure on it, boy, they some of everything. They all five gifts at one. All the fingers on your hand can't be the same thing. You got one hand, but that hand is comprised of five fingers. And all of them need each other. So what's the last thing? Conduct, communion, and yep, you guessed it, communication. And so this praying in tongues, this speaking in tongues has to do with communication. That's directly relatable to our experience with God and to one another. In other words, if somebody uses their ability or their gift or their baptism promise to speak to God, and the Bible says that, we'll see it in a minute, the Bible says that you speak mysteries. Greek word in the Gospels is mysterion. Mysterion. It doesn't mean that it's a secret. It just simply means that what was previously undisclosed or unrecognizable is now clearly seen. So we speak mysteries unto God. They may be mysteries to us, but God already knows. And when we yield to his order of allowing the Holy Spirit to pray through us, his will, then we move forward, or God's kingdom advances in accelerated fashion. And beloved, because we don't have much time, I don't believe we do, then we want to accelerate. Right? We don't want to decelerate. We want to get to moving. Amen? We got to get to moving. So it's the communication that has to do with our tongues. So that's what we're dealing with. So let's see. He says, even so, for as much, verse 12, you're zealous to spiritual gifts. Keep an eye on the clock here. But seek that you may excel to edifying the church. And again, if I didn't say it before, we're edifying ourselves. Not because we know we need to be built up, but we got to prove to somebody else how built up we are. Really what we want to say, I'm beyond that. Last week, I got a chance, some of you seen it on Twitter, my English teacher, everybody's favorite teacher, was here in Dover for a 50th anniversary. I'm at 48, but I got a chance to share with her her impact on our life, how her words still stay with us all these years. And then there are people that probably didn't get anything out of her class because they didn't value what she said. But I value what she said. In fact, my brother from California couldn't be here. He said, oh, tell her that the reason why I'm here today is because of what she taught me in English class. Because she didn't just teach English. She taught life. She taught us how to live. She taught how to have respect for others, taught us how to be gracious. And my favorite memories are, with perfect penmanship, she would go to the blackboard, which was green. Yeah, it was a blackboard. They called it a blackboard, but it was green. With the old chalk, you know, he had to slap the erasers together. And she would begin her class, morning, ladies and gentlemen. She wouldn't say boys and girls, Mr. Wallace. Would you care to step forward and do so and so? So always that type of thing. So she was teaching us about life. So you got to learn more than just navigating around churchy environments. As the minister said, really what we receive here is for out there. You were called in here to get ready to go out there with the right thing. Paul was lettered. Paul was an amazing scholar and a Pharisee and a Hebrew of Hebrews, but he was going about what he thought was the right thing the wrong way. So he had to come in, sit down, be trained up, and then sent out, and now the rest is history. Over three quarters of the New Testament is accredited to him. So let's finish this passage. He says, the idea is to edify the church. What's good for the church beyond what's good for you? If everybody prayed in the Holy Ghost, that'd be good for the church, right? If we had tongues with interpretation equaling prophecy, that would be good for the church. But he says, you've taken the grace of God with these gifts and torn it all to pieces. And so it has no value. So now everybody, remember, the problem with their conduct was this guy was looking for himself. The problem with the communion was they were out for themselves. They wouldn't leave enough for the people that got off work later. And the problem with the communication, even prayerful communication, it's all about us. Because we still have a selfish motive. And children, by definition, are selfish. They have to be taught unselfishness. So I can be a 50-year-old Christian that still has infantile, juvenile, and in some cases, senile outlook on what it is God's trying to do. And I don't care how much you pray in tongues. I don't care how much you go to church. I don't care how much you engage in religious activity. At some point, we got to grow. We got to grow up so we can grow out of what has kept us plagued in the past. I'm trying to finish. He says, wherefore him that let him that speaketh in an unknown tongue pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, watch now, here it is. We'll just touch the top of this. He says, whoever speaks in an unknown tongue. Let me say right off the bat, Paul is juxtaposing back and forth between diverse tongues with interpretation, which equals prophecy. Those two together equal prophecy. Prophecy is plain language, right? The spirit of prophecy, the book of Revelation says, is the testimony of Jesus. So you don't have to speak in tongues to testify of Jesus, right? So prophecy stands alone, but I need diverse tongues. 1 Corinthians 12, I know I'm covering a lot of ground, but you should have been here already. So diverse tongues along with interpretation equal prophecy, which is a language and a teaching or an utterance that could be understood by everybody in the house, right? And the reason why Paul was doing that is because people were mixing up those two. I'm going to get to verse 40. I just lay it on you before we leave. So they're mixing up those two. So you're people just blurting out in their prayer language. Then you had other people with the gift of prophecy, and they were excited about the proliferation of gifts in their church. Gifts don't make up for ignorance. You can have the gift of God and lay hands on the sick and be dumb as I don't know what. How do I know? You looking at... You can be just crazy. You can be crazy as hell, even though you're going to heaven. That's right. See, you have to shut the hell up so heaven can speak down. All week long, most of what you got was hell. He wanted to convince you that you're going to have a hellish experience. No, God wants us to experience heaven on earth. The kingdom of God has come to you, and the kingdom of God is living on the inside of you. Every believer, say with me, the kingdom of God is living inside of me right now. It's not by feeling. It's by revelation. It's not by what I think. It's by what God said, and I believe what God said. The kingdom of God is in me. What comes along with the kingdom of God is kingdom language. That's why we're talking about tongues. He said, I pray in an unknown tongue. Remember, unknown is added. It wasn't there. If I pray in a tongue, my spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful. So, won't turn there, maybe later. Remember where the Bible says you should be careful what you do with your body? And he says, and he says, I think 1 Corinthians 6, if I'm not mistaken, he says, what? Question. Yes. Do you know that what? Your what? Your what? Your body, your body, your body, soma in the Greek, your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which you have of God. Just think about that for a second. Your body is God's house. Can I just go a little deeper? Yo, my body is God's house. Now, when we meditate on that, we recognize already there's some things we got to correct. Whether it's natural health and eating right and getting our weight under control and all that, whether it's things that we choose to do with our members, we got to get all that wrapped up to be suitable. God says, I'm building you up as a habitation for the Spirit. I'm building you up for living space for the Spirit. The Spirit's got to live in you, right? Because he ain't in the building. He's in this building. Are you hearing me? That's why when you die, the Spirit of God leaves the same way when Jesus died. The Spirit of God leaves, but your body's still here because you need a body to function in the earth. You need a body with all its faculties to bring down the glory of God, for you to conjugate what that is, and then to work out a method and a methodology so that you are in service to humanity and you're improving everywhere there's a problem. Are you hearing me? He says, my spirit prays. So where's the Holy Ghost? In your? No, no. In your body, your soma body, your house. Inside your house is what? What spirit? Human spirit. Human spirit inside your house. What else? Your soul, psuche, which mind, emotions, our mental faculties, the seat of decision making, all that. That's what get caught in the vice grip of God's knowledge and man's wisdom. The squeeze play is in your soul. The squeeze play is, I know what to do is right, I just don't know how to do it. The squeeze play is, I know that's wrong, but I can't keep myself from doing it. So he says, renew yourself to the word of God by the Spirit of the living God, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Am I teaching all right? So spirit first, 1 Thessalonians 5, I pray God your whole spirit first. Spirit takes the oversight. Understand, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, lives in your body. When we pray according to 1 Corinthians 14, see, some of you just have to listen to this over and over. If we pray according to 1 Corinthians 14, our body isn't praying. You say, how can that be? I thought you said the Spirit, our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Yeah, our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, but I'm going to show you a mystery in a minute. It's the temple of the Holy Ghost, but your body isn't praying. Your spirit is praying, which is that part that's made in the image of God. John 4, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit. You bring your body here and leave your spirit outside. That's why some people think jumping around is necessarily serving God. It's okay. Sometimes myself needs to know that my body can worship God. But just because I jump around doesn't mean I'm under control of the spirit or not under control. So I have spirit, psuche, my mind. Watch this now. And because we don't understand spirit, we pursue the things of the mind. That's why some people, they're forever going to school. Is school bad? I want a doctor that went to school. A lot of school. Graduated top of his class. Follow me. Pass all his boards the first time. No, I want that kind of doctor, right? But some of us pursue education because we don't know our real value is in the spirit. See, like me, I started seminary, God stopped me. He said, what you going to seminary for? I said, because I just want to be, you want to be like everybody else. And I don't have any judgment about anybody that went to seminary. I just need to know what God told me. I said, God, I want to go. He said, you can't go. I said, why? Why? I had a seminarian a couple weeks ago, the Juneteenth speaker. He said, he's a seminarian, Dr. So-and-so, but we're sitting there talking. He's querying me with all these questions. I'm like, I wanted to be you. And we appreciate one another, and we're developing a beautiful relationship because he has something I need, and I have something he needs, and together we are better than if we ever didn't meet. Are you hearing me? But God says, you can't go. I'm like, why can't I go? He said, because what I'm going to do with you, I don't want a school getting credit. I don't want a school. You got your homiletics right, and you got your ministerial ethics right, and you got your doggone template for your message right. No, he says, I'm going to do great and mighty things, which you know not. People not, they're going to be like, what? He didn't go to seminary. They didn't have no training. They ain't even a businessman, this, that, and the other. No, God said, it's the Lord's doing. It is the Lord's doing. Come on, it's the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous. It's marvelous in our eyes. See, it's no great mystery if you had all the training, but when you do what even some trained folks can't do, then somebody said, that can't be him. That got to be God. God said, that's my point. It's in the spirit that we make a difference. Somebody give him praise. Oh, Lord, 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 Lord. And sometimes your schooling will get you stuck right here because you'll say that don't make no sense. It don't make no sense according to seminary. That's why I showed you scientific evidence. He said we can't discern whether it's God or not. But what we can discern is that it's something different. They speak in a language, but their language center ain't working because it's in the spirit. He says, if I pray in tongues, my spirit prays. Understanding, my intellect, the thing that I'm celebrating about everywhere, oh, they're so smart. Oh, they're so beautiful. Oh, they have such a wild intellect. Praise God for that. There's a place for that. But Paul said, I count all of that as manure. All of that. He had to knock me off my beast for me to even know that God was talking to me. He said, man, it's hard for you, man, with all of that. You're going about the wrong thing. How crazy is it for us to be religious and think that somehow that's pleasing God? And your religiosity makes you discount based on what someone else said with a degree that you're not supposed to speak in tongues. The devil. Come on, finish. The devil. Jesus said, you're going to speak with new tongues. What did he mean? They was going to leave there and start speaking, you know, Greek or Japanese or something like that? No, you're going to be speaking tongues from above. He said, you got to be born again, born from above. Now, born from above, kingdom means kingdom has its own language. Let me see. All right, cool. Because you know me, I'll keep going. So I'm going to leave you with this. I've told this story many, many times. But I could feel when the service began, I'm like, God, you're going to do something special. So I want to share with you just this little snippet from my own history, right? So that you've had a scientific example. You've had some of what Scripture has to say about it. And now I'm going to tell you how it became real to me, right? So you can know, you may have an escape, but you don't have an excuse. You can give a reason, but you don't have an excuse, right? So I grew up here in a Pentecostal church, real quick. Pentecostals, it's Pentecost. What happened on Pentecost? Folks spoke in tongues. So there'd be a few people speaking in tongues, and usually it's like, like Evan said, it's like, ding, 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 and people get in this frenzy about that, and there's space for that, follow me. You don't tear the building down, you don't spit in people's face, you don't do all kind of crazy stuff. But it is, because by and large, we're emotional people anyway, so our emotions get attached to that. But if you're unable to move a muscle, your prayer life, your prayer language should be just as vibrant. So I never really spoke in tongues. I tarried for the Holy Ghost. Jesus. Come on, Jesus. Revival be 3 weeks. This is how crazy it is. Revival 3 weeks long. Come on, call him. You'd be like, oh, gee. It's like being a Hebrew slave, you know what I mean? Oh, all right, get on down there. Get on down there. Some of y'all, anybody been at church? Oh. All right, start calling him. Jesus. Faster. Jesus. And in your mind, you're thinking, man, is this? I'm just saying, we can be religious and be toe up from the floor up. They were in earnest. And some people got the Holy Spirit's baptism that way. But I couldn't, there's got to be. Jesus, watch this bogey. Jesus wants me to have this. Why is he making it so hard? And here's the thing, Kenny, like what you tweeted out, you can't have your cake and eat it too. He goes, why not if it's your cake? I'm like, that is so nuts. So I'm here I am along with 15 other people with the piano going, and people singing and the tambourine and all that. And Jesus, you need to call on Jesus. Call on Jesus, Jesus. I'm like, at one point, it's like, he don't know his name. Why are we doing this? If my mama had to call me that many times, Tony, I'm gonna get it. You follow me? Boy, what you making me call you all? You should have came the first. Anyway. Working at the chicken factory. She working at one, I'm working at another. God supernaturally moves us into the military. We go down there with great hopes. I've been praying, fasting. I mean, just, we get down there. I look all over for a church. I want to encourage somebody. See, it's not the church of your choice. It's the church where God sovereignly sets you. So where did I start looking? I started looking for the Pentecostal church because that's what I came out of. And you know that holiness is right. Holiness or hell, and if you ain't holiness and Pentecostal, you're gonna bust hell wide open. The devil. The devil. It's the devil. The devil's a liar. Found a church, joined a church. Never went back. Joined one Sunday, didn't go back. It just didn't feel right. But I did what I thought I was supposed to do, right? So then I end up, some of y'all know Apostle Holcomb's church. And Goldsboro's had told us about it, and we went, my story, I was fussing all the way, backslidden everything, and man, well, it's way over there, so we drove 25 miles way on the backside of nowhere, and we walk in this little place, there's a little cardboard sign on the wall. I just want all you to know, don't worship God by appearance. You know what I mean? He may call you out a bush that don't burn up, right? So don't go by up here. Don't go by the big highfalutin church. People do that according to their status. No, sometimes that's what God wants to get out of you. So he sends you this little nondescript place where the word of God is being broke off left and right, but you can't receive it. I'm going to show you the next time we get together. I'm going to show you how that you couldn't hear God speaking to you. And he said, I'm going to have to speak to you in a new tongue. Isaiah chapter 28. I'm going to have to speak to you in a new tongue and still you won't hear. So now we're arguing and dividing the church over God says, this is my order. Right? Anyway, went to church, heard the word. It was crazy. I mean, I was excited. I was pumped up. Sunday morning, we go back across, and Mark said, what do you think? I'm like, I don't know what you think. Y'all know my story. We go back. I said, I think I'm coming back Wednesday night. So we come back Wednesday night, and here's the kicker. I don't know what he preached that first Sunday. I just knew that when we walked in, there was a different kind of atmosphere. Can I help you? That's why the devil is always intent and very consistent about disturbing the atmosphere here. Because historically, this is the atmosphere of signs, wonders, spiritual growth, camaraderie, teamwork. But there's a devil loose. He don't want you, no, he's afraid that you're going to discover who you are. He's afraid that you're going to realize, this is the place that God called me to. He's afraid that you're going to come into the discovery by revelation. So all these people and all these things are happening, and you did what the preacher said, and you went home, and hell broke loose. That's what's supposed to happen, because he says, I got to bring hell to you while the revelation of God is still fresh so it don't sink down. Right? That's how you get to abundant giving. You just do it. Keep doing it. Now it's like it's a non-negotiable, man. Like, be bold. I told y'all, I said, I'm done with my pledge, five figures or whatever you gave more or less. But I couldn't find myself stopping giving to be bold, be strong. And I think next week before, we going over so y'all can see just where we are. It looks the same on the outside. It ain't nothing like that on the inside. Thank you. Thank you for keeping your word. So real quickly, that Wednesday night, I didn't realize it. Maybe for like a year. But I started hearing these angelic voices around my head very faintly. You know, like the Vienna choir or something. Just wasn't conscious. Wednesday night, watch. This is where your cooperation counts. Wednesday night, I made up in my mind. I said, God, I don't know what's going on in this church, because I was desperate. Maybe you're not desperate enough. There's nothing like desperation. You'll throw people out the way. You'll shut friends down. Anything that's hindering you from, you know what God is saying. You got to come this way, son. You got to come this way. I don't care who was trying to stop me. I said, I'm going to go to this church Sunday, and whatever they putting out, I'm getting a hold of this, because when I looked around, you could actually see it on people. Yes. Right? Saturday night, you know the story, I won't take you through the whole thing. A demon shows up in my house. Here's the teaching. Be careful what you say out of your mouth. Definitely speak the word of God, but if you speak the word of God out of your mouth, just know the devil's coming for that word so that you don't receive what you just spoke. You have faith for what you hear, even if it's what you said. I said, Margot, we going back to this church, and I'm going to get what them people got. Can't wait till Sunday. Can't wait till Sunday. I'm all at work. Can't wait. Still hearing these voices, but not realizing it. Not realizing I heard my tongue around my head before it got released out of my spirit. So the devil comes creeping in visibly in my house that night, our apartment in East Killeen, Texas. And he's dragging his arm, comes to the end of the bed, changes form and all that. Next thing you know, he's choking the light. He's trying to kill me right in the bed. I sleep heavy. Margo sleeps light. She sleep. I'm awake wrestling this demon. That's how you know it's a supernatural component. Now, it's like a lot of these academics tell you, they don't believe in miraculous healing. Well, of course you don't believe in it because you don't preach it and it doesn't happen. Therefore, you're validated in your non-belief. But I'm telling you what happened to me. So, quickly, as I'm losing breath, I sense the voice of God inside me say, quick, release out of your mouth what you've been hearing around your head for 3 days. I never will forget it. I didn't even think about it. Paul said, I conferred not with flesh and blood. I didn't try to figure it out. I was simply obedient to the heavenly voice. Speak out of your mouth what you've been hearing around your head for 3 days. And I went, whatever. And as soon as it came out of my mouth, that demon jumped off of me and stood at the end of the bed looking at me like, yeah, that's right, dude. The jig is up, man. I didn't even know what happened. I looked, he looked, he changed form, feet came up, head came down. He turned into a Rubik's Cube, flew out the wall into the night. And I went, man, that's cool. And went back to sleep. Because let me tell you, my focus was, I'm going to this house, and I'm going to get whatever it is that these people got. And came Sunday morning, when they took us back to receive, I was off like a Honda motorcycle. Honda, listen. I'm just here to convince you that it makes all the difference. I don't care who don't want it. I don't care who don't need it. I don't care who don't believe it. He says the weapons of our warfare. I fought a demon that night. I fought that demon for like 10 seconds. And when I spoke in tongues, he shut out the door. We wrestling with demons weeks and months and years. I know I have. And you will have those principalities. It's not an overnight thing. You got to keep praying in the Holy Ghost. But for somebody to convince you, say, look, due respect, I don't have all the information yet, so you can just, you know, I'm sitting on something else. Because folks will shame you. Right. Folks will tell you you ain't a real Christian. Folks will tell you you ain't going in heaven. Do you know demons speak in tongues? I've been to healing meetings. People get healed miraculously, and you ask some of these academic people, they're like, you know, no wonder that Satan's transformed into an angel of light, and it's a false miracle. But you never said it was a miracle God could do. So now I know where your theology is, that the devil's falsehood is greater than God's truth. That's why you got to shut up or I got to leave, one or the other. Are you hearing me? Are you blessed today? I'm stopping right there. Are you blessed? Come on, stand on your feet. Stand on your feet. Give God glory. Give God glory. Come on, give God glory. Give God glory. Give God glory. Give God glory. So, thank you for your patience and your attention today. I don't know who I'm talking to, but you might be that one. There's always one that came to church like, God, I got to hear. You've been wanting people to solve your problem. The word says, greater is he that's in you. He says, if you're afflicted, you're supposed to pray. I wonder if that means praying in the Holy Ghost. It doesn't specifically say, but we know that praying in the Holy Spirit is a more excellent way to pray. Remember the pastor? He said, man, it's so amazing. He said, I believe in it. I see results. He said, but sometimes I sound like a complete idiot to myself. How many people that pray in tongues? You sound like an idiot to yourself some days. And that's his best chance to get you to stop. How many of you guys used to be world champion, gold medal, Olympic record curse word people? Oh, still got it going on. I see what I'm praying. That's why you need to be filled with the Holy Ghost, right? Right? Just one last benefit. They did a study in the UK of 1,000 evangelical Christians. And here's what they found. These people spoke in tongues, and they actually found empirical evidence to say, contrary to popular belief, that people are crazy. The people that spoke in tongues were less prone to senility, dementia, emotional distress. I'm telling you. I said, God, I want to put this across so you have no way of escape. There is data medically, scientifically. There's the authority of the scripture. And there's so many people around that pray in the Holy Ghost. You just need to get in. If it's not what God said it is, you can just drop it whenever. But I think you'll find that this is the power of God. So as we pray today, I want you to think about where you are. This is a no-judgment zone. You get to judge yourself. Just bow your heads. I want you to think about, where am I with God right now? Am I closer than I've ever been? Have I drifted off a little bit? I know God loves me. It'd be really great if I could love God just half the way he loves me. God sees you. God hears you. God says, we're going to make that happen. Don't reject me and don't run away. So I'm going to love you. And when you get where you think you're going, I'm going to be loving you there. So why don't you just come to me, wherever you are and however you are, and believe my word. That's the only reason why you're here, is to believe my word in this dimension and share that with as many people as you can in the time you have left. If you're here and you say, Pastor, pray for me, I want to do that. And just like I spoke to that demon, or I spoke to heaven regarding that demon 10 seconds, this doesn't take very long, but it does take your cooperation and maybe a sacrifice. You might have to sacrifice some shyness or some pride. And why do you say that? Because we don't always do it this way, but sometimes we do. While you're considering that, if you say, hey, I want a closer walk with God, I want to experience this new birth together with the Holy Spirit baptism. No judgment, doesn't make you a superior Christian, but it's a tool that you can use have tremendous success. Is there anybody that says, I want Jesus in my life? Is there anybody that says, right here, right now, based on what I heard, I want to come back to God. I didn't know he had all that for me. God wants you to win. God wants you to be everything that he sent you in the earth to be, but it's going to take your cooperation. While our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I'm going to pray, but I'm going to encourage you to begin walking. Just walk to the front right here. I'll meet you right here, and we'll pray together. Just start moving. If you're here and you say, I'm already saved, but I need to know more about this Holy Spirit. I want what God has for me. Thank you, my sister. Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you, my sister. I see you coming. I sense the heart of God is so for you today. Is there anyone? Anyone else? Anyone else? We're just going to wait a moment. Hallelujah. I heard the voice of God say, I died for you so I can wait on you. So I'm going to wait on you just a little bit longer. You know I'm speaking to you, so you recognize that unction, that willingness to want to move. He says, follow that, obey that. That's me. That's me leading your life, guiding your life right now into these new places in my will and in my kingdom for you. Anybody says, I want to know more about that Holy Spirit, I want to receive. I've never spoken tongues. Don't be afraid. Is there anyone? Glory to God. Finally, is there anyone that says, hey, I like this church. I didn't like it when I first came, but the more I come, the better I like it. It's really interesting. It may be where God has you, but we want to pray about that. Would you do me the honor of coming forward and just acknowledging that? You got to make any lifelong decisions today. But you just say, yes, I want to agree. Like I did years ago, I didn't know nothing about that church. I just know what came out of the man of God's mouth was exactly what I needed and exactly what I was praying about. So I had no hesitation. I simply moved out of my seat, came down and received the prayer of the house of God. Is there anyone else? Anyone else? Feel led to do this finally. If you're here and you have... Just listening. You have something wrong with you. You have an ailment. You have a sickness. Oh, yeah, thank you, Lord. And you want prayer for that, then I want you to come also. What I think we'll do is just pray over these, my two ladies here, and then I want to send them over for just further instruction after I pray. We're going to dismiss the congregation, but I'd like those of you that came just to stay for a moment. It's not going to be no long time. We're going to do the Holy Spirit thing, right? Okay. Thank you, Jesus. Man, I'm so blessed today. God spoke to our hearts today. I just want to say I thought about y'all too. Praise team, y'all been doing a good job. But does anybody need to receive the Holy Spirit? Anybody need to redirect and reconnect with the Lord? This is a time. It's not time to be shy or worry about how your gangster look or whatever. Jesus said, don't be afraid and don't be ashamed. Is there anyone else? Anyone else? And he also wants me to tell you that sometimes we'll come to be healed, but we won't come to be saved. I want what God has, but I don't want who he is. God's attitude, I believe, is, you know, I can work with that for a second. Because sometimes you getting healed is tied to your ability to believe him for your salvation. So I'm just waiting another 10, 20 seconds if there's anyone else. You believe in God today. Thank you, Lord. Think about it. You can move into next week, this week, with a newfound attitude, with a new refreshing, with a new fresh relationship with God. Anybody else? I'm telling you, I hear the voice of God. Somebody, this is what you've been grappling with. And after this, I believe this is it. This is what you've been grappling with. You're saying, there's stuff I know that's not pleasing to God. There's been such a stronghold in my life that's the reason why I'm not coming. In other words, you've got to a place where it's so familiar that you like it. And you're caught between an eternal decision for God and whatever it is that has you trapped, whatever it is that has you bound. Sometimes like a person on drugs, they want to get out, they just can't, they need a miracle. Somebody, I'm telling you right now, somebody is here like that. And I believe that today is your day of deliverance. We just don't do this to be doing this. God loves you, and God has come after you. Thank you. Is this your son? I thought you were his sister. I want to say this to you. Have you ever believed to be a Christian before? You have? All right. So I'm going to shame the devil right now, right? Okay. So today, let me just tell you what today is about. Today is just about starting. Got it? Because you may have plagued yourself about what you weren't able to finish or what you weren't able to accomplish. God said, I just need you to start today. That's it. You don't finish today. You just start today. And God says, for every day that you step with me, I'm going to be with you. I believe that because you came today, strongholds have been broken off your life, your mentality. You may have some decisions to make, right? How old are you? 17. Yeah, you may have some decisions to make because yours is a tough culture, right? But God says, I'm going to see you all the way through. And I believe that if you stay with God, you're going to be assigned to your generation. That not only can you do this, but you can do this with excellence. Amen. Does that mean? All right. Praise God. Let me pray. And then those of you that came, I think my sister, I don't know why my brother came, you two, I want you to go over there and just get the remainder information, all right? Father, we thank you now for this time together, and we glorify you in the name of Jesus. We thank you that love takes time, that, Lord, you give us time to digest. You give us time to mull it over. You give us time to think about it. In fact, repent means change the way you're thinking about me. And so I praise you for this moment of repentance. Really, from the pulpit to the door, we continually change how we think about you and your kingdom. Thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for your discernment. Thank you for your language. Thank you for your intercession. Thank you for your leading and guiding and directing. Thank you for your provision. And thank you for changing these people's lives once and for all, forever, in Jesus' name. Now with you two ladies, y'all came. Would y'all go over there? You two. Yes, you, ma'am. Yeah. Okay. All right. I just want to lay my hands on you, okay? Just lift up your hands. Father, I thank you for your power on this young man. Let him be everything you want him to be. He wants you in his heart. Thank you that you give him help through the power of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. You ever been filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking with other tongues? You ever heard about it? You have? What do you think? You believe in it? Okay, I just want you to stay right here. You can be filled. You believe it right now, right? Saved, got Jesus in your heart, all right? I just want you to lift your hands and wait right there. You'll sense something inside. And I believe you receive today. It's simply like when you pray the Lord's Prayer, our Father which art in heaven. Really, once you have that, you already have the Spirit of God, it's a decision to open your mouth and to really not think in English, but to let it flow out of you. It may sound like baby language, like the guy said, I sound like an idiot. But this is the greatest thing you can do in terms of your prayer life, all right? And I'm telling you, at 17 years old, you need the power of the Holy Spirit every day. You need to pray in the Holy Ghost every day. And I know for all of you viewing, I know we're breaking rules, but what we're getting ready to do is not diverse tongues with interpretation. This is what we saw in the video. This is believers praying in their prayer language, so there's no need for interpretation. In fact, let me bring you out right quick. 1 Corinthians 14:40, all things done decently in order. Remember, this church was out of order. God spoke to them about, here's how you bring the order because you don't want to be looked at as crazy. That was 2,000 years ago. We understand what's going on now. So we already set the order for what we're going to do. So it is decently and in order that you release to pray in your holy prayer language. And if God has a word, if we're free to do that. Does that make sense? I know people are going to say, you're butchering the scriptures, but that's why I didn't go to seminary. Okay, it's the Spirit that makes the difference. So can I get somebody just to stand over here with him? And y'all, just come here together, come here. You guys, y'all had something wrong with you. Don't look at me, y'all start praying, start singing, do something. Y'all start praying, all right? Do I have any elders that feel like they want to come up, lay hands on a sick, just lay hands. The Bible says, any sick, call for the elders. Here's the elders, right? Yeah, just stand in behind them. And what I'd like you to do, elders, and what I'd like you to do, if you're born again, just begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. I want you to pray in the Holy Ghost. Come on, let it flow. Let that flow, let that flow. Sir, you've been filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues. You're speaking in tongues behind that mask. Okay, lift up your hands to God. Lift up your hands to God. Whatever's wrong with you, we throw it out of you right now. Every disease, every sickness, every malady, everything that's wrong, in the name of Jesus, be made whole. Whole. Be made whole, be made whole, be made whole, be made whole. Crown of your head, soles of your feet. In the name of Jesus, be made perfectly whole in every way. Be made whole in Jesus' name. Be made whole in Jesus' name. No worry, no fear. Quit worrying about it. Be made whole. The word of the Lord has come to you. Be made whole right now. Body, come correct in Jesus' name. Lift up your hands, glorify God. Come on, give him thanks, give him thanks. Yeah, pray in the Holy Ghost. Yes, thank you, Lord. So here it is. We say by faith, it is done. I don't need to wrestle with no devil. He's defeated. I want to say to you, Mary, you, all of us, starting today, could we commit to pray, and some of you do already, pray at least 1 hour. Do you have 1 hour to pray in the Holy Ghost? This actually came up out of us for several Wednesdays. God says, whatever you're viewing, whatever you need, you need relief. You need rest. A lot of people are under stress, oxidative stress and other. God says, pray in the Holy Ghost. Wednesday night, I'm going to go into why the difference between your spirit, which prays, and your body, which houses the Holy Ghost, can account for your recovery from physical healing. All right? So I need you pray in the Holy Ghost this week. Yes? Yes? Don't. You remind me of the woman. You might want to practice just standing there, just praying. If you got to move around, fine. But just know it's not primarily emotional. It's a spirit conviction. Praying the Holy Ghost this week in tongues, David, Linda in tongues. I want you praying this week, individually and together. Pray in tongues, all right? Who Who can we get to commit to praying tongues this week in your personal prayer time? Yes? Yes. I want you to think about what we're committing to, myself along with you, whenever that is in the day. Let's pray in the Holy Spirit. I believe it won't be long. You and I are going to see results. We're going to see results. It won't be long. You're going to have some answers to some long-standing problems. It won't be long. And when you pray in the Spirit, know that everybody else in this congregation is praying in the Spirit. Amen? Amen. How we doing, Margo? Hey, he's just filled with the Holy Ghost, praying with other tongues, 17 years old. Yeah, yeah. Listen, beloved, listen. I so appreciate you. I so love you. And I so thank God for all of you. You're in my hearts and minds. As I pray in the Holy Spirit this week, I'll be praying with you and for you, for God's perfect will to be done in your life. God's grace is upon you as we leave this place. Amen. Amen. All right.
Has come to worship you, has come to worship you. Somebody call him Savior.